What up, this is Rama Screen covering movies, TV, and entertainment, and since we've come to the end of yet another decade, here is my list of 50 worst movies of the last 10 years. And by that I mean any time from 2010 all the way through 2019. I will also give you my very, very quick comments about each of them as well. So, without further ado, let's rock this. At number 50 is Jack and Jill. My God, it was painful to watch my favorite actor Al Pacino practically degrade himself in this film. And I think this is the movie where it was clear to everyone that the now Netflix star Adam Sandler's big screen days were done and over. At number 49 is Sex and the City 2. This is not supposed to be Sex and the Abu Dhabi. How dare this film took the ladies out of New York City? One of the worst sequels ever made. At number 48, The Boy. Okay, if I could be frank, I think The Walking Dead star Lauren Cohen is super hot. A major fox, a sexy bombshell, you get the picture. But this movie is total shite. At number 47, Hellboy. Believe it or not, I actually had high hopes for this reboot, especially when I heard that it was gonna be rated R, like hard R. But man, oh man, this movie turned out so bad that I betcha everybody involved with this project will now wish that they could erase Hellboy from their IMDb resume list. At number 46, The Happy Time Murders. The trailer was funny, at least I thought so, but the funny parts were in the trailers. The movie itself was repulsive and dreadful and didn't have any punchline that would get you to even chuckle. At number 45, Jonah Hex. Wow. Do you guys remember this catastrophe? On paper, Josh Brolin is the perfect man for the role, but the script was so bad, and Megan Fox could not act her way out of a paper bag, and this whole movie was just a giant mess. At number 44, The Hustle. The team-up of Rebel Wilson and Anne Hathaway should have worked, right? Because it's formulaic. One being the clumsy, bumbling, out of control, and the other is hoity-toity, uptight. Kinda like the Odd Couple thing. But the script was absolute trash, and none of the jokes landed. Watching this movie was one of the most painful experiences I've had in theaters. At number 43, The Forest. Ah yes, the movie where Natalie Dormer was kinda testing the water to see if she had what it took to be a lead in a horror slash thriller genre. Well, the answer is she didn't. And she should just stay on TV. At number 42, Dumplin'. Halfway through the movie, even the most die-hard Dolly Parton fans would have to admit that there is a better use of Dolly Parton's song somewhere out there, but not in this poorly written film. At number 41, The Emoji Movie. If I were to grade this film, I would give it 3 poop emojis because this movie was neither funny nor entertaining, and it was just another cash grab by Hollywood banking on what's popular in our culture. At number 40, Gotti. As a fan of mobster movies, I can't even begin to tell you how disappointed I was with this film. Gotti was an incoherent mess, and because of that, I couldn't care less about any of the characters, even if I tried. At number 39, Transformers: Age of Extinction. This is the first Transformers movie that did not feature Shia LaBeouf, but having Marky Mark as its lead did not make it any better either, because it was the same song and dance number, which was loud, clanging metal noises. At number 38, Angel Has Fallen. How this franchise has fallen indeed. Angel Has Fallen was a total ripoff of Harrison Ford's The Fugitive. Few movies I've seen in my lifetime that gave me headaches. Angel Has Fallen was one of them. At number 37, Beautiful Boy. I think one of this movie's biggest sins is that it tried too hard to be Oscar-worthy, but in the end, all that Beautiful Boy was is that it was a combination of anti-drug PSA and a bunch of privileged white people crying, "Woe is me!" At number 36, The Meg. I kid you not, I was this close to filing the Meg under the category of guilty pleasure. You know, movies that are bad or campy, but you'd watch it again and again just for fun or just for the hell of it. But this film's ridiculous third act completely ruined that plan. At number 35 is Left Behind. If you ever get the chance to watch this film on Netflix, don't. Putting aside this film's stupid religious themes, just from the writing and the performances, there are more than enough reason to hate this movie. And let's face it, Nicolas Cage just did it for the paycheck. At number 34 is The Mummy. This is the film that was supposed to lead the way for Universal Pictures' shared cinematic dark universe about their iconic horror monsters, remember? But you know it was disastrous when this movie's title character had to play second fiddle to Tom Cruise. At number 33 is 50 Shades of Grey. I watched this movie solely for the reason of checking out those kinky sex scenes. But jeez, they turned out to be laughable as opposed to sexy. I mean, this entire movie bored the hell out of me. I fell asleep twice watching it. At number 32, Winchester. Helen Mirren and Jason Clarke are fantastic actors, but Helen Mirren and Jason Clarke in Winchester are anything but fantastic. At number 31 is Baywatch. How dare this movie call itself a comedy when none of its raunchy jokes were funny? And what a waste of beautiful people! You have this sexy lineup from Zac Efron to Dwayne Johnson to Kelly Rohrbach to Alexandra Daddario, but you gave them shit material? What a waste of beautiful people! At number 30, Movie 43. I gotta admit, the part where Terrence Howard plays a coach giving his "You're Black" speech to his basketball team was kind of funny, but the rest of this film made you lose faith in comedy. At number 29, The Hangover Part 3. You know, I think if the first Hangover movie never had sequels, it would have been great as a single standalone timeless comedy. But nope. They just had to go and fuck it all up by staining this franchise with Part 2, and especially Part 3, which for whatever reason had a tone that went unnecessarily dark. At number 28 is Rings. I really feel bad for all the actors in this film, including Big Bang Theory's Johnny Galecki. Nobody really ever asked for another Ring movie, much less a shitty one. At number 27, Assassin's Creed. Ah yes, another fallen victim to the eternal curse of video game-based movies. Hollywood never stops trying, and Hollywood always fails. At number 26, Suspiria. God, this movie was just grotesque. Because even though the dances were hypnotic, the story slowly but surely took a turn for gross and disgusting. At number 25 is Ghost Rider: Spirit of Vengeance. You know, I actually like director Mark Neveldine and Brian Taylor's eccentric, unorthodox style of filming, which includes rollerblading while holding the camera. But at the end of the day, it's all just gimmick if the script is terrible. At number 24, Dirty Grandpa. I don't have a lot of regrets in my life, but I do regret sitting through this torture session. This film was nothing but a string of one unfunny sex joke after another. At number 23 is Fantastic Beasts: The Crimes of Grindelwald. It was hard for me to stay awake during the screening of this Fantastic Beasts sequel. I wish it was back to just being about Newt and his many creatures, but the way they expanded the story, it was just too convoluted. I couldn't follow what the hell was going on. At number 22 is Robin Hood. Nobody asked for another Men in Black movie, and definitely nobody asked for another Robin Hood movie either, goddammit. And nobody cared that it starred Taron Egerton and Jamie Foxx. At number 21, The Twilight Saga: Breaking Dawn Part 2. Look, you know me. I freaking love Kristen Stewart, but I couldn't stand any of those Twilight movies. How that franchise got to be so popular was beyond me. Especially this final installment, which was basically a case study for what not to do when making a movie. At number 20, Ghostbusters! Listen, the reason why this reboot sucked was not because it featured all female lead. It did not matter if the stars were leprechauns. The movie would still suck. On top of that, Chris Hemsworth went full idiot in this one. Never go full idiot, dude. At number 19, Independence Day Resurgence. The first Independence Day was a classic. This sequel, however, was mind-numbing. It went on and on forever, and it did not offer anything remotely close to exciting, let alone memorable. At number 18 is Cats. This movie spent too much fucking time on introducing this cat and introducing that cat. It was goddamn irritating. This is one Broadway musical that should have just stayed on the stage. At number 17, Transformers The Last Night. Oh boy, here we go again. Another round of Michael Bay's headache-inducing Transformers installment. The definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, hoping for a different result. That pretty much sums up Michael Bay's Transformers movies, including this one. At number 16, Suicide Squad. This movie could have been badass. It could have been a contender instead of a bum, which is what it was. Not enough Jared Leto's Joker. The story was all over the place. The story was incoherent. And Cara Delevingne was the worst villain ever. God, I hated this movie. At number 15 is Ghost in the Shell. Or should I say whitewashing in the shell. All that this movie shows is how clueless Hollywood is when it comes to adapting stories or materials from Asia. At number 14 is The Spy Who Dumped Me. I probably would not have minded this movie at all if it had actually been funny, but the whole buddy comedy of Mila Kunis and Kate McKinnon was just not effective. At number 13, The Predator. Oh my god, I was so looking forward to this movie. Wow, what a huge letdown. The Predator was problematic and chaotic from the start, and come to think of it, it wasn't substantive either. At number 12, Glass. M. Night Shyamalan's very own shared cinematic universe failed to deliver. The film's One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest wannabe and its unsatisfying, uneventful, anticlimactic ending made me realize now more than ever that M. Night Shyamalan's storytelling prowess is long gone. The only silver lining is James McAvoy's impressive performance, but with that said, I wouldn't be caught dead re-watching Glass again. At number 11, Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice. Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice was trash. There, I said it. Come at me, bro. This movie was a pile of garbage, and it was nothing more than a mindless Justice League infomercial. At number 10, Battleship. What's more amazing than the fact that this movie was god-awful was that it ran 2 hours and 11 minutes long, I kid you not. Every other movie that came out that same year, even the shitty ones, sunk this battleship. At number 9, The Snowman. If you ask me what I remember from watching The Snowman, honest to God, I would not be able to tell you. If I'm being nice, I'd say that there's a big chunk from the book that this adaptation left out, but I'm being way too nice there. At number 8, Collateral Beauty. Will Smith wrote to love, time, and death, and we, the audiences, wish that the letters had been returned to sender. I naively thought that 7 Pounds would be the last soulless movie that Will Smith ever did, but then Collateral Beauty came along and said, hold my beer. At number 7, Mordecai. Do you know those movies that are so lame, they make you angry because they take you away from other more productive things that you could have done elsewhere? Well, Mordecai, starring Johnny Depp and his stupid mustache, was one of those movies. At number 6, Slender Man. This horror movie was generic, it was predictable, it was poorly written, it was badly acted, it was super boring. I think the lore or the urban legend of the Slender Man itself is more scary than this film. At number 5, Gods of Egypt. This movie felt like the attack of cheap CG visual effects. The fact that it did not feature any Egyptian or Middle Eastern actors was like the fifth thing that was wrong about this movie. At number four, The Lone Ranger. What the fuck was that bird on Johnny Depp's head? And why did this movie put me to sleep? And why did I not give a shit about its train action sequence? At number three, Mile 22. Iko Uwais is a talented on-screen fighter, but his skills were wasted in this movie because director Peter Berg did not know how to shoot Iko properly. On top of the fact that Mark Wahlberg's character was an unlikable total jerk and the action sequences were completely rudderless. At number two, Holmes and Watson. Writer-director Ethan Coen is a terrible joke teller. It's obvious with this film that he was just throwing things against the wall, hoping some of them would stick. And all that Will Ferrell and John C. Reilly did in this movie was yell and scream and yell some more. And now, the number one worst movie of the past decade is M. Night Shyamalan's shitpola, The Last Airbender. This is a bad adaptation of what is actually a fun animated series. And if that was not troubling enough, the good guys or the heroes were all light skin, while the villains or the antagonists were all dark and brown skin. Everything about this movie was so cringy. So that's it. That's my list of 50 worst movies of the past decade. What does your list look like? Share them in the comment section below. And as always, subscribe to my channel, press that like button, and ring that bell so you can get notified whenever I post new videos. And if you would like to help support this channel, please do so at patreon.com/ramascreen. That's patreon.com/ramascreen. Let's rock this!